Tri-State Worship Center, our aim isn't to be the best church in the community, but to be the best church for the community. We're here to encourage the saints, help the hurting, and embrace all people. At Tri-State Worship Center, there's a ministry for everyone. So if you're looking for a place to grow and serve others, or just need some additional encouragement, we've got you covered. We like to keep it casual and very friendly. You'll barely make it through the door without being greeted with a smile and a handshake, or even a hug. About a dress code. We don't have one. The important thing is that you come. So come in what you have, and we'll go from there. It's our vision to be a beacon, a light, a celebration of hope, a hope that we can only find in Jesus. We only ask one thing. You've tried it your way. Why not give his way a try? We'll see you at church.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Tri-State Worship Center. I'm Pastor Terry. This is my lovely wife, Vicki. We're excited to have you with us this morning. We're a church
go
in South...
Go, Vicki. That came from the back before
anyway, Someday I'll get my cheering section, and it'll be in heaven.
Wah, wah.
Yeah, everybody's like, you ain't going. Welcome to Tri-State Worship Center, where we encourage the saint and help the hurting and embrace all people. I was saying that for you folks on Facebook. Thanks for joining us
today. Good morning, Facebook.
Take it, Vic. I like you more.
Okay.
Than me.
So if you're a first-time guest or viewer, if you will text the word welcome to the number on your screen, we'd appreciate that. We have a gift card for you. Also want to just connect with you.
I was waving. I'm sorry.
I thought you were doing this. Regular tenders, text the word here to the same number. It just kind of gives us a way of knowing you're here if we miss you, and we'd appreciate that. Thank you so much.
We're not going to stop the service here in a little bit to receive an offering. We don't do it that way. We ask you to drop your tithe, your offering, your building fund commitment, your missions giving into these boxes that are on the wall located throughout the building, or you can text to give at 740-370-4342. You can... go to our website, tswc.org. If you're watching us by Facebook, you can hit shop now. If you're here in the building, you can go to the kiosk out in the foyer. However you do it, we've made it as simple as possible for us to take all your money. So please help us out as we continue to take the
we
money.
We try to accommodate everybody the best
yes,
we can.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so you've probably heard the last few weeks, we are already collecting items for the Shoebox Ministry. So go to any of our Tri-State Worship Center pages. Go to the Shoebox post and click the Amazon link, and those are the items that we need. Good morning, Julie. Items that we need. And if you would just purchase one of those items, it'll come directly to the church, and we've made it as easy as possible. Also, the Avad Backpack Project is underway. They're collecting items for school backpack giveaway, financial donations accepted as well. Also, on Tuesday, we are having a meeting here. It's going to include Avad and all of the ministers that want to be involved in the South Point area for the backpack giveaway. If you own a business or you want to be involved in some way, feel free to come, but please RSVP because lunch will be provided. So it's going to be here at Tri-State Worship Center Tuesday at noon.
Not giving them lunch.
What are you not?
Just snacks.
Sorry, snacks. All right, you lost a lot of people right
well,
there.
Well, no, it's at 1 o'clock. It's at 1 o'clock.
They're not interested.
We did it at 1 so they would go out and eat before they
okay,
came.
Okay, 1 o'clock. But we want to just invite you, if you want to get involved, please get involved. So if you want to come to that meeting, please do. Okay, so Wednesday night, classes for all ages. We're encouraging everyone, if you haven't come on Wednesday nights, please do that. Also, take it away, Tyler. We have a swim mission trip video for you.
In the darkest night, you bring the morning song. Sing over me, you know I need it. You will lead us all home. There is a light chasing the human heart, the breath of life, redeeming every part. Breathe over me, you know I need it. You will lead us all.
Thank you to Tim Barnett and the team that went to New Mexico. Great job. Very proud of you all. We are going to do just a portion, small portion, of the girls' night out last Tuesday, just so you can kind of see what we do.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring. Bound by wild desire, I fell into a ring of fire. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire. The taste of love is sweet when hearts like ours meet. I fell for you like a child.
We just have a lot of fun at Girls Night Out. We encourage you to come hang out with us. That was a really fun project. And thank you, Andrew Stoll, for the video and that song.
Yeah, now we're going to know that, I'm sorry, that Johnny Cash thing, it came on me. I don't know what happened. Let's stand. We put our prayer list up on the screen and on our Facebook pages so that you can refer to it throughout the week. As you remember all these needs, we got a lot of people with a lot of needs. How many have a need this morning? Let me just see a hand real quick. Does anybody believe God's able?
Amen.
Anybody really believe God's able?
Yes.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for your awesomeness. Just thank you for being a great God. A God that loves us and cares about us. A God not far removed from our circumstances, but a God that's intensely involved in our lives, and for that we're thankful. We pray this morning you just touch these needs that are listed on our prayer list, as well as those who are represented by an uplifted hand. God, we know you're able to do all things. So just reach down from the throne room and supply those needs according to your riches and glory through Christ. And then let us hear some reports of victory. We pray this morning you'll bless the offering, bless those who give, multiply it for the upbuilding of your kingdom. God, in everything that we do today, let us point somebody to Jesus Christ. We love you, we praise you, we bless you, for it is in Christ's name that we pray. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Turn around and tell somebody you're glad to see him in church. Don't forget, if you're a first-time guest, we encourage you to text the word welcome. If you're a regular attender, text the word here to 740-244-8694. Gives us a way to keep track of who's here. And if you're a first-time guest, we have a little card, gift card we'd like to send you. Tonight at 6 o'clock is our men's fellowship dinner. We haven't had one for a couple of months for just different reasons, but we will be having one tonight. Free food, free fellowship, and a devotional. So I encourage you to come as we're going to continue our journey on manhood restored, but abbreviated devotion tonight because we're going to spend some time fellowshipping. So if you can come, please come. Last week we started a series called Furnace Grace. Furnace Grace. And we asked the question, how should we live? How do we live when the heat gets turned up? And we went to an Old Testament story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And we looked at their steadfastness even when the heat got turned up, even though Nebuchadnezzar tried to cancel their personality by changing their name. He tried to change their posture by getting them to bow before the image. And he tried to hijack their purpose. But they refused, as we found out last week. And the heat was turned up 7 times. And there's a lot that we can learn from their story. There's a lot that we can learn on how we should live when the heat gets turned up in our lives. And we ended last week by traveling back into a couple of Old Testament stories. One was the book of Job. And we wondered how Job would respond when the heat got turned up. And here's what he said in chapter 1, verse 21. He said, I came naked from my mother's womb, and I'll be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had. The Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, I'm not here to preach this particular message this morning, but you and I need to understand something as believers, that we will never live a victorious life until we get the right mindset that we don't own our stuff. It's not our stuff. Oh, but I worked hard for that, Pastor Terry. No, the Lord enabled you to be a steward of what you have. It's not your stuff. And as long as we think it's our stuff, when we lose that stuff, we can lose sight of who God is. But Job said, listen, naked I came, naked I'm going. The Lord gives, he takes it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And even though his wife said, why don't you just curse God and die? Job said, if I can curse God and die, then I can bless God and live. He said, then that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to choose to put my trust in him. And then we asked what David would say. David, all the things that David went through from the time he was a shepherd boy till he became king. How would David respond when the heat was turned up? And we found that in verse 6 of chapter 30 of 1 Samuel. When David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Some of y'all need to quit waiting on a preacher to come by and encourage you. Some of you need to quit waiting for the cheerleader to come by and cheer you on. Some of us need to just preach to ourselves. Some of us need to encourage ourselves, just like David did. When the heat gets turned up and we don't know what to do, we should encourage ourselves that God is in control and this stuff's not my stuff anyway. It's his stuff. I've been reading a book by Bob Roden called Four Faces of a Leader. It talks about Jesus being a shepherd, a servant, a steward, and a seer, one who could see the future. And in this book, I found this quote. It says, when confronted with a challenge, the committed heart will search for a solution. The undecided heart searches for an escape. I think we live in a world of believers and non-believers that have been looking for an escape. Looking for the escape in relationships and addictive behaviors and eating too much and shopping too much. When in reality, we need to just trust the Lord. So I hope this morning to encourage those of you that are committed, but I hope to challenge those of you that are undecided this morning. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for today. Thank you for your awesomeness. Thank you for being such a great, great God. I stand behind this sacred desk and I know, Lord, that there is nothing within me that's good, but I know that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So I pray that you'll touch my mind and give me clarity of thought, touch my mouth, give me clarity of speech, that I might somehow, some way, share a word that you've laid on my heart. So just help us this morning. Give us a teachable spirit. I pray that in Christ's name. Someone say amen.
Amen.
Today I want to talk about four lessons from three men in one fire. Four lessons from three men in one fire. And I've got a long way to go and less time to get there. So we're going to jump right into it. The very first thing that these three men taught us when the heat got turned up is that they remained convinced and they did not compromise. They remained convinced and they did not compromise. Go with me again to Daniel chapter 3. The three Hebrew boys, you hear their response again in verse 16 of chapter 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. In other words, they're saying, King, we are so convinced. We are so convinced of God's goodness. We're so convinced of his faithfulness. We don't even need to stop and think about answering you. We don't need to take a vote. We don't need to somehow negotiate between ourselves. We know, listen to this, we know that God is able to deliver us from this fire. We know that. And because we know that, not just knowledge of it, but it's changed our hearts, because we know it, we're not going to compromise. We are convinced that we're going to stand. We may not know how God's going to get us through it. We may not know when he's going to get us through it. He doesn't have to explain to me why he put me through it. All I know is he is able. All I know is he can do it. And compromise, in and of itself, not a bad thing. Matter of fact, we live a life of compromise. We take and we give, and we do that in a lot of relationships, in our marriage. But if we're not careful, we end up falling victim to what the great theologian Glenn Campbell once said, that we are going to get a load of compromising on the road to our horizon. And that's the problem with too many believers today, is that we find ourselves in positions where we feel like if we give in just a little bit, we might help this circumstance or we might help this situation. And the reality is that these three Hebrew boys stood there and said, listen, we're convinced and we're not going to compromise. We're going to stand. And because we're going to stand, we know that God is able. And what I'm talking about today when we use the word compromise in this particular message and in this context is we're not going to compromise the word of God. Listen very carefully to what I'm going to say, because doing so will bring fatal results into your life and into the lives of those that are around you. We cannot compromise what the Word of God says. Now listen, if you know of the outcome of a situation, there's really not a reason to compromise. The only reason you compromise is if you think you're going to get a better result. Now listen, we know how this is going to end. The trump of God shall sound. All the dead in Christ will rise first. Those of us which are alive and remain, be caught up with the Lord. We know how it's going to end. Why would we compromise? If you know how it's going to end and you know it can't get any better, compromising is only going to be worth it if there's a changed outcome, and there is no changed outcome. Listen, there's a heaven and there is a hell. I cannot water that down. I can't dilute that. And what we've got to do is learn how to stand. And that's what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they understood that at the end of the day, they were not going to bow. At the end of the day, Nebuchadnezzar was not going to change his mind. So they decided, we're going to just thrust ourselves into the hands of an almighty God. And we're going to trust him because we know he's able. We know he can see us through. We know that by nightfall, things are not going to be different. So we're going to trust the Lord. Listen, they were not going to bow. Nebuchadnezzar was not going to change. Things had to be put into the hands of God. And in full disclosure to you this morning, the longer that I walk this thing called the Christian journey, the more I realize the dynamic I need most in my life is this steadfastness, that there's no compromise. No compromise here. When we give a little, it starts a slippery slope. When we give a little, it starts a downward spiral. And we see it happening in churches and in the community of faith around the globe. We see it happening all the time. But I have to tell you this morning that my mind is made up. It's made up in my life, in my marriage. Now, when I say this, those of you that have had the unfortunate happenstance of, of divorce, I'm not talking about how many times you've been married this morning. I'm talking about the marriage that you're in right now. There are no options. There are no options. Your mind has to be made up. The first thing I tell couples when they come for counseling is divorce is off the table. There is no such thing. Because as long as that option is there, we're human and we're going to take the path of least resistance. I know it's going to get quiet. Listen, it's okay. I'm confident. And we've got to understand that there's no compromise here. I've been married for 43 years. I'm going to be married to Vicky until either Jesus comes back or one of us dies. Someone once said to me, never say never. You just never know. No, I know. I'm convinced. I'm not compromising. Now, the question will be whether I want to live miserably with Vicky the rest of my life or whether I want to be fulfilled. So I'm going to work on that part. It amazes me how quick we are to compromise, how quick we are to somehow give up on what should be the bedrock truths of God's word. And I'm here to tell you that my strategy is no compromise in my marriage, in my relationships, in my life, with my relationship with God. Listen, if the Bible says what the Bible says about heaven, that's what I'm going to preach about heaven. What the Bible says about hell, that's what I'm going to preach about hell. If I need healing in my body, I'm going to preach divine healing because that's what the Bible says. And when the Bible says this is sin, I'm going to call it sin. I'm not going to try to dilute that or water it down or somehow remove it so that it'll make it easier for people to hear me. I know some people say, well, it seems like if Jesus was preaching this morning, sorry, but if Jesus was preaching this morning, it seems like all of us would trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey what he says. But yet the Bible tells us that's not what happened when Jesus was preaching. Go to John chapter 6. Even some of his followers said this. On hearing what Jesus was teaching, many of his disciples said, man, this is some hard teaching. Who can accept it? That was verse 60. If you run down to verse 66, it says that from this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. Why? Because Jesus preached some hard stuff. You can look all throughout the New Testament. Every time there was Jesus was around, there was a big crowd around him. But in most of those cases, that crowd began to wean down once Jesus started teaching what he was teaching. Because it was hard. But he didn't dilute it. He didn't change it. He didn't water it down. He said, this is the word of God. Now listen, I don't deny that somehow, some way, we can change a method of delivering the good news, but you can't change the message of the good news. Jesus Christ, him crucified, buried, and resurrected, ascended to heaven. But yet there's this spirit that's alive in the world today, not just in the world, but unfortunately it's crept into the church, that says somehow, some way, we can put pressure on believers to compromise what they believe, because that's a little bit more tolerant. That's a little bit more acceptable. The enemy wants to delete the truth. I said that last week. I'm going to say it till Jesus comes back. Because he's relentless about the schemes that he uses to try to get us to compromise the truth. Well, Pastor Terry, it's hard to talk about an exclusive Jesus in an inclusive world. You cannot change that. If you change that, it changes what you believe. If I believe there's only one way to get to heaven, and that's through the name of Jesus, but yet I tell you the path that you're on is okay, that changes what I believe. What I believe then is not true. I have to be convinced that there's no compromise. Someone asked me recently about that verse in Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, where Jesus said, you think I've come to bring peace on the earth, but I didn't. I came with a sword in my hand. Well, I think that Jesus said that's a spiritual warfare that we are all fighting. We fight it every day. And it's not always going to be peaceable. As much as it depends on you, be peaceable with all men. It's what the Bible says. But it's not always going to work out that way. Sometimes we have to be honest enough to say, this is the truth of God's word, and I can't change that. Jesus never apologized when his preaching offended somebody. He didn't go, oh, if I haven't made you mad yet, this will really get you. He didn't go chasing after people who were offended at what he said. He showed kindness. He showed compassion. He showed mercy. He showed grace. But he didn't go running after anybody. He didn't change the message just to appease the listener. You say, Pastor Terry, that's a hard thing. I can't help that. You need to go talk to God about that because it's the Word of God. Sin is sin. Heaven is heaven. Hell is hell. And we can't change that. We can't make it easier for people. As a matter of fact, before we move to point two, and there's four, diluting the message of the gospel, it may bring more people into our church, but it produces in them this shallow, wavering faith. A shallow, wavering faith. And remember, what we win them with is what we win them to. You water down the gospel just to win more people, you're not winning them to the true gospel. You're winning them to a watered-down gospel. And that's what you win them to. And we've got to be careful with that. Are you going to just let the enemy rewrite the Bible and not stand up for what is right? Are you going to let the enemy just change what the truth is and not be convinced without compromise, even though the heat gets turned up, to stand up and say, no, this is what the Lord says? We are to remain convinced and not compromise. Secondly, remain positive. Remain positive in the problem. Quit being an Eeyore Christian every time something doesn't go your way. Oh, God hates me. He done forgot where I'm at. After telling Nebuchadnezzar that they did not need to deliberate or take time or to vote to answer him, look what chapter 3, verse 17 says. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. I don't know if you can hear. Can you hear the positivity in that? Listen, King, we know who you are. We understand that you're over all these provinces, that you have a great big nation, an empire, if you will. But we know that God's able to rescue us. He's able to save us and rescue us from your hand. Listen carefully. I want someone to listen to the positivity of those three words, or those words. The God whom we serve is able. I'm glad I got three people going with me. I need our minds to chew on that for a minute. Maybe even personalize it. The God whom I serve is able. You know, the reason why a lot of people don't get too excited when you hear that statement is that that's not the God they serve. I'm looking this way. I don't want to really look over this way. Just looking up. Some people are just serving the wrong God. Because the God that I serve, he's able. He spoke things into existence. He said, let there be, and there was. That's the God I serve. And no matter what my circumstance shows, no matter how hot the fire might get, he's able to deliver me. It's all over the Word of God. Go to Jude, verse 24. It says, now all glory to God, who is able to keep you from falling away and will bring you with great joy into his glorious presence without a single fault. What about Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20? Now all glory to God, who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. What about 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8? And God is able to make all grace overflow to you so that, always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. Those three Hebrew boys declared something that you and I need to learn to declare, and that is God is able. And it testified of the positivity of their faith. Sometimes we have believers that go through tough times and you crumble, and your unbelieving friend says, that's what happens to me when I go through tough times. Why would I believe in their God? Instead, we need to stand strong in what we believe. No compromise, be convinced, and do it with positivity. You know what the problem with some of us is? We have junk in, junk out. These guys knew that they were headed to the fire. They knew they were headed to the fire. They didn't know what that was going to feel like. They didn't know what that was going to be like. That was not their problem. That was not their concern. All they knew was, we ain't bowing. And we're not bowing, and we know that God's able. Somehow, someway, we know God will do this. And I'm not talking about some kind of positive thinking thing from Zig Ziglar or some of those positive thinking experts. I'm not talking about mental calisthenics where we just begin to, I know I can, I know I can, I know I can. I'm not talking about, I'm talking about believing in the Word of God to the point where we say, He's able. God can get me out of this. I know He can. And the key to remaining positive, listen carefully, the key to remaining positive in these difficult times is having the right relationship with Jesus where He can pour into us the Word of God. The problem is that we spend more time looking at other people's Facebook pages than we do listening to the Word of God. Some of y'all need to quit being baptized in everybody else's negativity. Man. And let me just say this while I'm here. You social media drive-by accusers who hide behind your computer screen, one of these days the Lord is going to let me punch you in the throat. One of these days. Until that day, I'll be praying for you. Listen to me. You may need to rethink who you're hanging around with. Well, you don't understand. Little Jimmy's been my friend since I was 2, and you've been the most negative person since then, too. No, they didn't like it. Some of you need to limit your media input. You know, back when I was growing up with David Brinkley and Chet Huntley, anybody remember those guys? They just reported the news. This is what happened. Nowadays, this is what happened, and here's what I think about it. Some of us need to just start cutting the news out because all it is junk in and junk out. We don't need their commentary. As a matter of fact, what we need more now than ever is to listen to the words of Paul in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. He said, now, brothers, as I close this letter, let me say this one more thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true, what is good and right. Think about things that are pure and lovely and dwell on the fine good things in others. Think about all that you can to praise God for and be glad about that. Be glad about that. Now, I don't know, maybe you have mastered the art of being glad about something while you got a frown on your face. I mean, I'm telling you right now, those of you that are not smiling, ugly. Ugly. See, and you just now, you and it's so pretty. Handsome for you guys. There was a mother peeling vegetables for a salad for her daughter. Daughter was home from college, and the daughter casually mentions that she's going to go see a movie that has some questionable things in it. So the mother suddenly reaches over and grabs a handful of peelings out of the garbage and throws it in the salad. And the girl's like, Mother, what are you doing? You just put garbage in the salad. And the mom said, well, I thought if you didn't mind a little garbage in your mind, you certainly wouldn't mind a little garbage in your stomach. We've got to protect this thing. We have to guard that because the enemy, he's a sly old fox. He knows exactly what to do. So you and I have to remain convinced with no compromise. It's God's way or no way. He's first place or he's no place. He cannot be almost saved. You cannot almost be a believer. You have to know without any compromise, this is what I believe. Not only that, but we've got to remain in that situation. Whatever it is that the Lord brings my way, He has enabled me and empowered me to remain positive in that time because God is able. God is able. Third thing, remain worshipful in the worst of times. Remain worshipful even in those times that seems to be the worst. Now, I know what some of you might say, some of you big theologians out there, you say, well, you know what? The words praise and worship don't appear in this passage. And you'd be right. But the actions of praise and worship are all over this passage. Listen to me. This account that we're reading shows us that they stood for what they believed. They didn't bow down to other images. And that's the ultimate expression of worship. Is that they literally, listen to me, they literally laid their lives down for God. They said, listen, you can throw us in there. We know our God is able. He may not, but if He doesn't, we're still not bowing to you. At the end of the day, we're not compromising because we know in whom we believe. And we have this bedrock truth that we're going to stand on regardless. Paul is writing to the Rome, to the Christians in Rome, and really to all generations in Romans chapter 12, verse 1. This is my favorite verse in the Bible, this along with verse 2. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you, Paul is saying, give your bodies to God because of all that he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that the people that you live with find tolerable. There's a reason why there's only one screen right behind me now. Because those of you that were ignoring me by looking over there, you have to find something else to do. Because now it's back there. That's not what it says. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to him. Who's him? He will find acceptable. God. That's truly the way to worship. That's truly, you want to know how to worship? Yeah, play me my favorite song. Turn the bass up a little bit. No, those are good things. You can ask Tyler. I tell him all the time, listen, you can't ever have the bass up loud enough for me. I want to feel it right here. But that ain't got nothing to do with praise and worship. That just has to do with what I like. Well, I didn't like that song. Well, we weren't singing to you. These guys said, we're going to give it all. We're going to give our bodies, literally lay down our bodies. We're told in Psalm 22 and 3 that the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. The word inhabits there means to be enthroned on. To be enthroned on. Can I tell you that that's exactly what the three Hebrew boys were doing? They were praising God, and God was enthroned on what they were doing. The presence of God sitting on a congregation that praises him. Now, I don't know if you can get that picture in your mind, but that is exciting. Man, to think that as we lift our hands and say, our God is able. And when we do that and we say, Lord, it doesn't matter what happens to me. It doesn't matter what happens to the stuff that you've given me. Naked I came in this world. Naked I'm going to leave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And when we lift our hands and we praise him and we thank him for that, that's worship. It's not about a song. That's part of worship, but that's not worship. It's exactly what these three Hebrew boys were doing. We can read about it. They were tied up, thrown into the fire. The Bible says this. Daniel chapter 3, verse 24 and 25. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, and he rose in haste, and he spoke, saying to his counselors, did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said to the king, true, O king. Well, look, he said, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Now, Sandra Stevens sent me a link last week after she comes to first service, and it was Johnny Cash singing that song, Fourth Man in the Fire. And she thought it was important that I play it, but I'm not going to because we've already had a couple videos. So I'm just going to sing it. I'm not going to sing it either. Well... the fourth man in that fire, Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nisi, my banner. El Shaddai, God is more than enough. I don't care what you're going through right now. It's not about what you're going through. It's about what you believe. Because belief plus believer determines behavior. And if I believe God is able, I'm not compromising. I'm not giving in. I'm convinced that he can see me through this. How many times have you been on the edge and didn't know? There's no safety net down there. You know the next step has, I don't know where it's going to lead, but I know God's able. I know God can see me through it. I know that he is Jehovah. Now remember, just a little bit earlier in verse 13 of chapter 3, Nebuchadnezzar asked, who is that God that's going to deliver you out of my hands? Who is it? Who are you talking about? Who are you talking about? Now go with me to heaven for just a moment. You know how my mind gets sometimes. These three Hebrew boys are tossed into the furnace. What is going on in heaven in that moment? I don't know about you, but I kind of hear God saying, they spoke up for me. They stood up under the pressure, great pressure. And because they stood up for me and they spoke for me and they stood up under this pressure, I'm going to go be with them. Sometimes we wonder, where's God? Well, what's your confession in the midst of the heat being turned up in your life? What is your confession? Is your confession, he's able, he will see me through this? Because I think when God hears that, he's like, I'll be back. I know God's sovereign, okay? I wrote a book about it. I know he's everywhere all the time. I'm just metaphorically saying, God's like, I'll be back. I got to go be with them. And even Nebuchadnezzar leans over and says, wait a minute, there's somebody else in there. I don't know who told you. I don't know who told you that God's presence is restricted to only the pleasant times in life. But that's not true. He's not restricted to just the pleasant times. On the contrary, I think the opposite could be true. Anytime, anywhere that his children need him, God is there. No matter where that's at. Might be in the checkout line at Walmart. Lord, you need to help me right now. I'm going to say something to get me in trouble. His presence is wherever his children need him to be. Man, I don't know how we can get away from that. He promised that to us. He promised those things to us. If you've ever messaged me or called me or talked to me in a time of trouble, more than likely I gave you Isaiah 43 to read. Because here's what it says. When you go through deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. Didn't say if. You're going to go through it. If you haven't, you will. If you're there now, take this promise to heart. I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you'll not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you, for I am the Lord your God, your Savior. Why don't we just feast on that for a while and forget about everything else? Forget about what social media says. Forget about the news. Forget about everything else. Just know that God is able. He's able. We need to cultivate that in our lives and not all this negativity and not all this, I'm not sure, I hope God knows. No, we need to foster this knowing, this attitude of gratitude. He can see me through. He will see me through. It's his promise. It's not natural. Listen, it's not natural. I get it. It's supernatural. And guess who can help us with supernatural? Only the Lord. Only the Lord. So we need to remain convinced, not compromised. We need to remain positive in the problem. Here's the third thing is remain worshipful, even when it looks like it's the worst. Here's the last thing I'll share with you this morning. I think we need to learn from these three guys. Remain at rest with your resolve. Remain at rest with your resolve. That's the fourth action I think we need. Let's look one more time. I know we've read it several times. Let's look one more time. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16, 17, and 18. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God, if that being tossed into the furnace, if that's the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. Look at these words. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. But if not, focus on those three words for just a moment. Let me ask you something. Was this some kind of a statement of doubt by these guys? Was this some kind of a escape clause that they were coming up with? Some kind of a divine escape clause or an escape hatch that they decided, well, we know God's able, but now let me tell you, if he doesn't, let me stand right here, right now, and tell you, this is those guys' unflinching resolve that they said, we know he can see us through, but if he doesn't, doesn't matter. Because it's not about the blessings that are coming from God's hands. We're not just going to believe in God when he's blessing us. We're going to believe in God as part of our life. That's what we do. And even when we find ourselves where the heat is turned up, we're not bowing to anything else, regardless of whether we get delivered from it or not. If he doesn't, in essence, what the three Hebrew boys are saying is, King, you need to know that our commitment is not based on the material blessing that God pours out. You need to know that our commitment to God is not based on whether he's being good to us at the moment in our minds or not. Our commitment to him is based on his integrity. His integrity is he's able, but if he doesn't, I still ain't bowing, because at the end of the day, the word of God doesn't change. At the end of the day, we might have to go through the water. We might have to go through the fire. He will be with us. That's the truth. That's what we need to get a hold of. So before we pray, what is this thing called grace? If we're going to have furnace grace and learn how to live when the heat's turned up, what is this thing called grace? And if you've been in church, you've heard songs about it and sermons about it. You've taught lessons about it, no doubt. But the original word is charis. As a matter of fact, if I would say it as a Jewish person, it's charis. I just like doing that. It just sounds cool. Makes me feel more spiritual, too, when you do that. Don't do it, though, because somebody might think you're trying to do something else. Here's what it means. A supernatural impartation from God that he graciously gives that enables, empowers, and strengthens us. Now, see, maybe I'm saying this wrong. If I'm saying it wrong, forgive me. I think that believers in Christianity, we've sissified grace. I think we've just made it wimpy. Listen to that definition one more time. A supernatural impartation from God that he graciously gives and enables, empowers, and strengthens us. We just think about grace when we're getting ready to eat sometimes. We just think about grace when we sinned. But what this says is that it's a supernatural thing that God gives us, especially when we're in some difficult times, to strengthen us. It's the kind of grace that transforms a person, that changes them, to be able to do things that we couldn't do before. It's the kind of grace that will allow us to forgive what we thought we couldn't forgive. It's the kind of grace that will hold us in the times when the heat gets turned up, we didn't think we could do it. But when we decide we're convinced we're not going to compromise, we're going to stay positive, we're going to worship the Lord through it, then we can rest in the resolve of knowing that his grace is sufficient. That supernatural ability that he gives me, that strengthens me and enables me. So when I walk through the furnace, we're referring to supernatural ability that comes directly from God to navigate extremely difficult circumstances and situations. How come we've not looked at grace that way before? How come we don't allow grace to be that for us? To guide us in the difficult times, to help navigate the troubled waters. We've got to learn to do that. When we have God's grace, we're going to know it because it's going to manifest itself in an outward demonstration of some sort. See, we think it's just the power of the Holy Spirit that's going to do that. It's the power of the Holy Spirit that's going to put God's grace in your life. And God's grace is the supernatural ability to do things we didn't think we could do. And these guys had it, man. These guys had it. And what is it that we need? What do you have to do to receive the grace of God? So simple. Ask for it. Ask for it. What's the prerequisite? A humble heart. Ask for the grace. Have a humble heart. Listen to James chapter 4, verse 6. But he gives us more and more grace, power of the Holy Spirit, to meet this evil tendency and all others fully. That is why he says, God sets himself against the proud and the haughty, but gives grace continually to the lowly, those who are humble enough to receive it. Ask for it. Be humble. And the Lord says he's going to give it to you. Linda, if you'll come. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 29. How much worse, sterner, and heavier punishment do you suppose he will be judged to deserve? How much worse, sterner, or heavier punishment do you suppose he will be judged to deserve who has spurned and thus trampled underfoot the Son of God? And who has considered the covenant blood by which he was consecrated, commonly and unhallowed, thus profaning it? Here's what I get to. Insulting and outraging the Holy Spirit, who imparts grace, the unmerited favor and blessing of God. It's the Holy Spirit that gives us grace. As a Pentecostal church, we should be full of grace. Supernatural ability and strength to do things we just didn't think we could do. That helps us to stand and rest in the resolve that we have. It reminds me, of the Apostle Paul. He's in prison in Rome. He knows that death is coming. He knows that death is. Matter of fact, he looks out the prison bars. He sees the shiny blade of the axe that's getting ready to separate his head from his body. He knows it's over. Matter of fact, he can hear the rattling of the chains, of the keys that's going to unlock the door that's going to lead him down a hallway to a place where his life is going to be taken from him. He did not acquiesce. He did not compromise. He did not give in. He did not say, listen, if you won't cut my head off, I'll do this. That's not what he did. But yet he was strong enough and confident enough in his resolve that he writes to us in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, I have fought the good fight. You don't hear him poor mouthing. Here I am in prison. I've planted churches all over the Roman Empire, and God done forgot where I'm at. That's what some of us would probably write. He said, no, I fought the fight. I kept the faith. I finished this race. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. That's the kind of resolve I want to have. Even in the face of the difficult times, even in the face of the fiery trials, is to say, listen, devil, you can do whatever you want to do. It's not going to change what I believe. You can label me. You can cancel me. You can wake me or whatever it is that they do nowadays. It's not going to change a thing. God is the creator of all things. Man sinned and fell from grace. Jesus died on the cross so that we might be restored back into right relationship. And he is the only way I'm going to make it to heaven. There's no other way to make it. And I want to stand in that resolve. In that resolve. That's what these three Hebrew boys did. We're not going to compromise. We're going to believe the Lord will see us through. But even if he doesn't, we're not bowing to you. We're going to believe in the Lord God Almighty. Stand with me. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for the promises of your word that tell us that when the heat gets turned up, we can stand convinced knowing that you're with us. You never leave us. You'll never forsake us. That you're able to deliver us. But even if you don't, we don't bow. Even if you don't, it's because we don't know what you're doing. You've got something else in store. Because you're a sovereign God. Everywhere, all the time, all powerful and all knowing. Nothing happens in this world that you don't know about. I pray, Lord God, somehow we can have that kind of resolve. That kind of resolve that even in the midst of the fiery trials, we'll stand knowing that you are able. Help us this morning. I pray that in Christ's name. Keep your heads bowed for just a moment. If you're here this morning, you're not in a right relationship with Christ. I can tell you right now, you need Jesus. You need Jesus. Because when the difficult times come, he'll be with you. And even when it's smooth sailing, he'll be with you. We cannot get from this life to the next without him. He is the only way, the way, the truth, and the life. Someday, every knee is going to bow, every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And you can do that this morning, right now. So if you're here, you're not in a right relationship with him. You can be. The decision is yours. So as they sing, if that's you this morning, would you come? Let me pray with you. Not in a right relationship with Christ. Come, and let's pray together.
Your name is power. Your name is power.
ask one more question before we leave. I wonder if there's somebody just bold enough to say, you know, the heat's been turned up, and I need what you've been talking about the last 2 weeks. I need to not compromise. I need to stand. I need to worship God during this time. I need to be positive, and I just need the grace of God to help me do that. Let me just see your hand real quick. I want you to keep it up there for just a second. Look around. You ain't alone, right? You ain't alone. We got a lot of people that need that kind of grace. Would you just reach over and grab the hand of the person standing next to you, and let's pray one more time. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, grace. God's grace. Let it fall. Let the supernatural ability, the supernatural strength that comes through the power of your Holy Spirit, let it reside in us all. Lord, for every hand that was raised, whatever the circumstance might be, whatever the situation might be, I know you are able. And so, God, let us stand with our hands raised, with a smile on our face, knowing that there's no compromise, and we're going to rest in that resolve, knowing that you are able. So in Jesus' name, I'm believing that for every hand that was raised, mine included, that we will sense and know the grace of God that enables us and strengthens us to get through these times. Help us, Lord, I pray in Christ's name. Everybody said, amen. Listen, if you believe it, walk in it. Belief plus believer determines behavior. If you believe it, walk in it. Walk in it. Don't forget tonight at 6 o'clock, our men's meeting. Come join us. I love you. God bless you. We'll see you the next time.